Hello and welcome to News Today. I am Kemini Nyamani. Amano, coming up, University of Ghana legal team says it is studying the documents of the suit served them last Wednesday on their decision to charge tolls on the university's roads. Ahead, Association of Ghana Industries Business Barometer report reveals the biggest challenge faced by businesses in the manufacturing sector is high utility prices. Former leader of Uganda's main opposition party, the Forum for Democratic Change, says his struggle is not about being president, but one that seeks qualitative changes in Uganda. Details coming up in a bit. This is News Today. The University of Ghana legal team says it is now studying the documents of the suit served them last Wednesday on your decision to charge tolls on the university's roads. Legal counsel Echan Afre Ahen, who spoke on Joy FM Super Morning Show, said the legal team of the university did not know what the university had been sued for.
Two persons took the university to court on its decision to charge tolls on its roads beginning February 1. The suit is seeking to stop the university from charging two cities as a road user fee without parliamentary approval. The plaintiffs are also contesting the exclusion of university staff and their dependents from paying tolls. The University of Ghana says it is yet to study the suit to know what they are being sued for.
I do not know at this point. We've just been sued. We have to look at the documents very well, what we've been sued for. We are currently discussing that. The legal advisors of the university will discuss that and then we will come out with that in due. As I said, the decision that was taken was that the money was for the construction and then also charge these fees for both the payment of the loan and maintenance of the roads. So I'm not sure that it is just for the period of the payment of the loan in due course.
According to the university, its legal team is meeting on the suit and will take a decision after studying the documents. The legal team, however, fell short of saying that the February 1 date takeoff would be possible. The university also clarified who is to pay the tolls and said though staff of the university will not pay, it will be based on certain conditions.
Lecturers, I think that the statement that came out stated that the employees of the university will not pay. As regards council members, I don't know. I'm not sure that the students are going to pay or are not paying. With respect to employees, I think it was stated that the employees will not pay. But that is not a blanket rule. It has conditions attached to those. The vehicle must be in the name and with other conditions. I mean, it must be clear that the car is for you. So if you are using somebody's car, it is not going to be free.
The University of Ghana wants to introduce the road tolls to cover costs incurred for rehabilitating roads at the university.
Ghana Director of Amnesty International Lawrence Amesu has described the destruction and seizure of tents by security forces for victims whose houses were demolished as callous. Speaking to Joy News, he was worried the situation has gone beyond human rights abuse, saying it was time for some heads to roll.
All along, Amnesty International has been drawing attention to the fact that people who live in slums or people who live in it that we say they are living there illegally are still human beings and their human rights should be protected all times. We are very surprised that even after breaking down all those buildings and people are living in outside their buildings, and they are living under tents with little children as young as 3 months. People should go in midnight and still break down their tents. I think it has now gone beyond human rights abuse. This is callousness. And I think that we should call the president's attention to this situation now. It is important for some heads to roll. Then people can begin to appreciate that no matter what a personal situation is, status is in the society, that person should be respected. Mm. The human rights of those people should be respected. I think we have gone beyond human rights abuse now. This should be described as callousness and some heads to roll. To be a kind of a precedent for other people to behave other than what is happening now in our country. It is important for us to take action at this time because when the issue came in first, I was thinking that, well, maybe it was going to be a one-time issue. But it appears that the PLA is doing this with impudence and we should now take action quickly. Somebody has to take an action. You have to go to the court to protect people's lives at this point of time.
The Ghana Pentecostal and Charismatic Council has called on government and other religious bodies to spearhead efforts for the formation of self-regulatory bodies that would check activities of independent pastors and churches. In a communique signed by its chairman, Apostle Dr. Opoku Onyina, and General Secretary Samuel Enchi, the council expressed worry about the charlatans who are denting the Christian practice. The Pentecostal and Charismatic Church leaders underscored the need for setting up of the quasi-formal regulatory bodies since Ghanaians are becoming disillusioned with Christianity and religion. The council says activities of these charlatans parading as pastors have become too rampant. Reverend Dr. Kwabena Oponifrimpo is General Secretary of the Christian Council of Ghana. He's joined us over the telephone. We'll pick his thoughts briefly on this. Hello, Reverend.
Hello, my sister. Good afternoon, and good afternoon to your cherished listeners.
Absolutely. Good afternoon. But, Reverend, what is the Christian Council's take on this?
In fact, I must say that we are in total support of the position of the Ghana Pentecostal Council.
Mm.
It's a position that is the position of Christian Council of Ghana, too.
Is it not possible for both councils to do this without the intervention of government?
You see, we are living in a country that is regulated by laws. And therefore, there are certain things, as long as the laws of the land allow an individual to do, you must be very careful how much you go into it. Elsewhere in Ivory Coast, you can't start a church without belonging to one of the Christian bodies in the country. But the laws in this country at the moment allow any individual who can find a classroom or a mango tree or anywhere to start a church. It is very good on one breath, but on the other side, it's making monitoring of our colleagues who call themselves ministers and all that difficult because they are protected by the law.
Reverend, I was asking because I mean, when it came to money matters, we didn't want the involvement of government with regards to taxes, but then we want government to come in and then regulate the practice.
No. I must be very careful here. We are saying, of course, let me say this is the Ghana Pentecostal Council. But if you ask Christian Council of Ghana, in fact, we are not even saying that the government must come in just to serve as a police person. The government is not a theologian. But we are saying that the Christian churches in this country must accept that to plant a church, you must belong to one of the Christian bodies. It's like the TEC groups that you find, whether you are in this union or in whatever, you must belong to one of the groups for monitoring purposes. We are not by that saying a government should set up a desk or a unit somewhere to control churches in this country. That is not what we are saying. Among ourselves, that understanding must be, and then a framework must be done that anybody planting a church in this country must belong to one of the Christian bodies. For us to correct ourselves, monitoring, and making sure we are serving God and we are serving this country properly.
Very well, Reverend. Thank you very much. For your time. Reverend Dr. Kwabena Opunifrimpo is General Secretary for the Christian Council of Ghana. Move away from that. And in adequate contact hours between teachers and pupils of the Odumase Amanfrom MA Primary and Junior High School in the Ghana West District of the Greater Accra region is hampering quality education and resulting in poor performance. Inadequate classrooms have also resulted in the school still operating the shifts system after it had been phased out a long time ago. Eric Itishawa's report.
Like most communities in the Ghana West District, Odumase Amanfrom is not without some challenges. Its educational infrastructure is in a very poor state. The only school in the community is in dire need of infrastructural development. For close to a year now, GHS 1 pupils of the school have had to study under trees until this makeshift structure was put up by the Parents Teachers Association of the school. The makeshift structure, however, has its own challenges.
It's very terrible teaching under this shade. Sometimes when it's raining, the rain disturbs us, and we have to close from school. And sometimes when you are teaching and the sun is shining, the children have to move forward from, especially those sitting at the back, the sun disturbs them, so they have to move forward. And sometimes when you, the teacher, you are writing on the board, the sun rays disturbs you a lot, so it's very bad.
Right behind me is where the headmaster of the Odumase Amanfrom MA Basic School 3 sits every day to carry out his work. The headmaster is not alone. The teachers of the school also sit under sheds to also carry out their academic work.
Is this my office?
How is it like sitting here?
It's not the best. It's not comfortable because sometimes the weather is bad and there's nothing I can do than to keep doing my work because that's my work. I love it.
The headmaster office had this torn paper box, which serves as the only storage facility for files and documents of the school. About 10 meters away from the headmaster's office is the teacher's common room. This is the makeshift structure that teachers of the Odumase Amanfrom MA Basic School 3 call their staff common room. One wonders what happens when the rain sets in or the sun becomes too hot for them to sit in.
We need school building. The major thing is the school building. We need school building to be erected because we don't have. For now, if you go to the other classroom, the population is also huge over there. Even the sea, we are not getting any place yet. And the district is doing well, but we need the government to come to our aid, put up at least a structure for that can contain the children.
The school is also forced to run a shift system, with teachers complain, reduces contact hours between them and the pupils.
With time, the population grew, and due to the population, the school was divided, and so we had C, which we come 7 and close at 12, and the others 12 to 5 o'clock. And you're looking at it, it affected teaching and learning activities, because there are other subjects that need more time to be taught. But due to the shift system, we are not getting time. We are not getting enough time to teach, and it's affecting the children too.
It has been over our population in the enrollment, and as a result of that, we're running shift, which is affecting teaching and learning. We have to come to school close at 12 o'clock for another stream to take over. It's not really helping the case.
And even with the shift system, classrooms are overcrowded. An ideal classroom to enhance effective teaching and learning must contain a maximum of 30 students. But this is not the case here in this school. I am in a class 3 classroom. There are over 60 students here in this particular classroom.
Your name?
Benny Francis.
Benny Francis. Benny Francis, how old are you?
I'm 30 years old.
You're 30 years old. What do you want to be in future?
Nabil.
Emmanuel.
Nabil.
How old are you?
10 years old.
You're 10 years old. What do you want to do in future?
Soldiers.
What's your name?
Solomon Foy.
And how old are you?
10 years.
What do you want to be in future?
Teacher.
The pupils here have big dreams and counting on the school to give them the needed foundation to achieve that. Eric Etis Howard, Joy News, Odumansi Amamfrum.
Hiring people with little or no training to teach helps increase enrollment, but often with dire consequences, such as poor quality education. UNESCO's report on the progress of the education for all mentions average pupil-teacher ratios have barely changed at the pre-primary, primary and secondary levels. 23 countries in sub-Saharan Africa have some 40 pupils to one teacher as the standard.
Improving quality education and learning, the report says, is likely to be more central to the post-2015 Global Development Framework. Such a shift is essential to improve education opportunities for the 250 million children who are unable to read, write, or do basic mathematics. The pupil-teacher ratio is one measure for assessing progress towards education for all. In sub-Saharan Africa, for instance, teacher recruitment lags behind growth in enrollment. Teacher-to-pupil ratios have stagnated and are the highest in the world. Of the 162 countries with data in 2011, 26 had a pupil-teacher ratio in primary education exceeding 40 to 1. 23 of those countries are in sub-Saharan Africa. Many countries expanded teacher numbers by hiring people to teach without training that get more children into school, but jeopardizes education quality. In some situations, the presence of female teachers is important to attract girls to school and improve their learning outcomes. Yet, female teachers are few. Teachers have no access to quality teaching and learning aids, even though they are crucial. The report cites poor physical infrastructure as a problem, with children often squeezed into overcrowded classrooms. With 250 million children without basic education, global post-2015 goals are necessary. These should monitor whether all children and youth, regardless of their circumstances, acquire foundation skills in reading, writing, and mathematics by 2030. Meeting this need requires countries to strengthen their national assessment systems and ensure that they are used to inform policy. Regional and international assessments are also critical for monitoring a global learning goal after 2015. The number of years young people spend in school is one measure of overall progress in access to education.
A foundation has been set up to honor the legacy of ace Ghanaian BBC broadcaster Komla Duma, who passed away this month in London. A statement issued and signed by a spokesperson for the Duma family, Esther Koba, explained that the Komla Duma Memorial Foundation is aimed at sustaining the legacy of Komla Duma by pursuing plans he had for promoting the ideals that he stood for and worked for. The statement said the foundation will also seek to promote excellence in journalism with particular emphasis on broadcast journalism and initiate programs for the development of African youth as well as the education of his children, including his own three children. In the statement, the family of Komla Duma has given details of her bank account for monetary contributions from philanthropists, friends, and well wishers. Komla Duma was a presenter of BBC World News and Focus on Africa program before his death on January 18, 2014. The BBC has also indicated its preparedness to establish a bursary in honor of the boss player who was committed to telling the African story in all his reports. The Minister of Roads and Highways, Alhaji Hamidu Sulemani, is not pleased with progress of work on the Takwa Bogoso Ayamfore Road. The project, which was to be handed over by June 2014, is only 23% done. Sarah Mabladi Souza was with the minister during the inspection tour and has filed this report.
From Bogoso Work on the 70 million euro EU-funded project has been slow, resulting in a delay in the completion date, which is slated for July 2014. The contractor blamed the non-availability of suitable rocks for the delay.
According to the contract document, the contractor is supposed to acquire his rock from mine to GAG. But when we came to execute the project, we couldn't. The rock was not suitable. So we had to look for another source, and it took time. And finally, we find the suitable rock in Kwapia.
The resident engineer for Gotmi, the supervisors and consultants for the project, Chandra Selinki, was hopeful their proposal for extension of time to June 2015 will be approved.
The top of Bogoslo has not yet started. It is 30 kilometers. They applied for some subcontractor to do the job. We are analyzing whether the subcontractor will be capable of doing it or not.
The Minister of Roads and Highways, Alhaji Amidu Suleimani, however, insisted work must be done with urgency.
The contractor will have to double his work, particularly during dry season, and do a lot of work. But this, if we're having an extension, it will only be up to 2015. And that is if, since for so many years nothing has happened, we don't know what will change in 1 year. But the contractor has to double, which he has assured that he will.
Government is passionate about the 94.4-kilometer Takwa-Bogoso Ayanfuri Road, which links the three mining towns of Takwa, Bogoso, and Ayanfuri.
Still in the Western region, the Divisional Chief of Presia Hemanana in Tobua Pra is urging government to institute investigations into the operations of military personnel in mining communities.
The activities of the military personnel and some police who come to the mining communities, if they are come to protect their mines, they should go there and leave the community folks to do their normal businesses.
He made the appeal when the Minister of Lands and Natural Resources, Alhaji Inusaf Husseini, and Minister of Roads and Highways, Alhaji Amidu Suleimani, called on him at his palace on Wednesday. Nana Ntebwa Pra IV also discredited allegations that the community's recent demonstration was against the anti-Galamsey tax force in the area.
Pristia Heman or Heman Pristia have not demonstrated against anti-Galamsey tax force set up by government to ensure that there is sanity and proper regularization of small-scale mining activities in our community. The entire community will not do such a thing or such, excuse me for my word, nonsensical act to block the activities of government. We won't do that.
Alhaji Inusaf Husseini assured him of government's commitment to ensure mining communities benefit from the resources their land play host to.
It is part of the promise His Excellency made to your traditional area to make this mine meaningful in the lives of the people of Pristia. Investing in the youth, investing in the people is one of the themes of the NDC.
Alhaji Amidu Suleimani, however, debunked suggestions that his visit is at the instance of a demonstration held on Tuesday by the people.
We are not here because of any demonstration. I did inform Nana on the 14th of January, and we told him that we are coming here. It's part of our program as ministers of state to ensure that we move around to see programs in our area and ensure that we also know at first hand the problems that confront our sectors so that we address them when we get back to Accra. Road construction is a very expensive enterprise, and we did say that we will construct the road, and we are on course constructing the roads.
Up Up north, stillbirths and maternal deaths are increasing in the Wa Municipal Assembly. The Wa Municipal Health Director says it is unacceptable to record 203 stillbirths in 2013 and appeal to the Wa Assembly to improve infrastructure to health centers to reduce this.
At the Municipal Health Performance Review at Wa, poor infrastructure was also identified as the cause in the increase in maternal death from 5 to 8 in 2013. The Wa Municipal Director of the Ghana Health Service, Beatrice Kumfa, said the year 2013 witnessed lots of achievements in the field of public health. According to her, there was a tremendous improvement in antenatal attendance in the year under review, resulting in less cases of home deliveries.
With regards to maternal and child health, more pregnant women were attended to this year in the past years. But what is the quality of the care we provide? We have also been able to make a significant improvement in the registration of pregnant women within the first 3 months of pregnancy, from 59% to 64.1%. This can be attributed to the many interventions, including the pregnancy classes organized for women and their spouses and more mothers in the various communities.
She mentioned inadequate funding and shortage of critical care health staff, midwives and medical assistants for service delivery as challenges confronting the directorate. The Deputy Upper West Regional Director of Ghana Health Services in charge of public health, Dr. Kofi Issa, entreated community health officers to be time conscious in the discharge of their duties. In a related event, the Nadoli District Health Director, Florence Asongring, gave an overview of the health situation in the district to stakeholders.
You're watching News Today. I'll be right back. You're welcome back. The latest Association of Ghana Industries Business Barometer report has identified 10 challenges as the biggest ones faced by the manufacturing sector in Ghana. The biggest challenge faced by businesses in the manufacturing sector is high utility prices, with close to 50% of businesses naming that as the most challenging. The report revealed competition from imported goods is the least challenge faced by Ghanaian businesses in the sector. The manufacturing sector growth has dwindled over the years, and the Ghana Statistical Service figures recently released shows Ghana's manufacturing subsector recorded a negative growth of 4.7% for the third quarter of last year over the second quarter's negative growth of 19.8%. Peasant farmers are asking the National Food Buffer Stock Company to review their prices and involve them in their price negotiations. They are also worried about the deplorable nature of the company's warehousing and want government to quickly step in to resource it.
A survey conducted by the Peasant Farmers Association of Ghana on the buffer stock scheme using 904 respondents revealed that only 31.6% of them were aware of the scheme. 84% of the farmers had never sold their produce to the National Food Buffer Stock Company, NAFCO, and as high as 94% indicated that they have never benefited from the scheme in times of food shortage. Although the National Buffer Stock reaches the farmers through licensed buying agents, 71% of them are unaware. The few farmers who are aware of the scheme and patronize it had 80% of them dissatisfied with the price offered by the buffer stock company.
We are talking about cost of production. Even though in the midst of subsidy, we still say the fertilizer price is high, cost of seed is high, generally inputs. So at the end of the day, the farmer would like to match his inputs against the cost of production. And that is where the price can be determined. And so that is why we are equally asking that the price negotiation should involve farmers. If the farmers are part of the price negotiations, it means at the end of the day, the price offered is satisfactory to all parties.
The farmers asked government to intervene in resourcing the National Buffer Stock Company.
In certain areas, don't even have warehouses where they will put the produce. And so government should come out with more warehouses so that the Buffer Stock Company can be expanded to the district and the communities. Because as we speak, from where I come from, the National Buffer Stock Company regional office is located under a tree in Tamale. And the farm produce they have bought is put kept in cocoons. And as I'm speaking, some of the food is going bad.
They have also urged NAFCO to work closely with the Extension Department of the Ministry of Food and Agriculture to do more education and sensitization on the buffer stock scheme.
Meanwhile, the director of operations at the National Food Buffer Stock Company, Ken Akwe, says the company is having a hard time fully executing its mandate due to deep financial challenges. The company has since 2009 not received any capital injection from government, apart from the 15 million cedis it invested in its operations when it was established in 2009.
The buffer stock company is mandated to ensure security for farmers by mopping up excess produce in order to reduce post-harvest losses and to protect their incomes. But NAFCO is dealing with its own peculiar challenges, key amongst them being funding. Out of the 130 million cedi initial capital injection suggested by the post-harvest team, which established NAFCO in 2009, government could only provide 15 million cedis. The state of affairs leaves NAFCO incapacitated with dire financial and operational constraints.
If we are going to look at expansion, then obviously expansion comes with a certain cost. So the funds now is covering just our purchases, and we are unable to put in other items. We are looking for certain facilities. We have approached the EDIF fund, and we are hopeful that maybe within the next few months something positive should come out.
The scheme has also not been able to attract a number of farmers due to the bad state of NAFCO's warehousing, which poses another challenge.
We don't have the logistics. We are short of warehousing. We don't have enough funds to go in and say we are buying every bit of the surplus that may be available. Okay, if you take 34,000 metric tons warehousing capacity, and you have a surplus of in the range of about 400,000 metric tons of maize alone, I mean, obviously the difference, the gap that has to be covered, is enormous.
Regardless of the challenges, NAFCO says it has been able to sell to poultry farmers and feed millers 253,000 bags of yellow maize out of the 270,000 bags imported by the Ministry of Food and Agriculture for sale to the poultry industry. The Ghana School Feeding Program has also since February 2012 received a total of 240,000 bags of milled rice. Abigail Adamagwenchi for Joy News.
Japan's consumer prices have risen at their fastest pace in more than 5 years, marking more progress in the country's battle against deflation. Data show the core consumer prices, excluding fresh food, rose by 1.3% in December from a year earlier, which was higher than market forecasts. The latest figures give a boost to Prime Minister Shinzo Abe, who has pledged to end 15 years of falling prices and revive economic growth. Japanese stocks rose by nearly 1%, and investors were also cheered by Japan's employment and manufacturing data released on Friday, which provided more evidence that Asia's second biggest economy is recovering. Japan's jobless rate fell to 3.7%, in December, and its lowest level in 6 years, while factory output rose. The world's biggest car maker, Toyota, has told dealers in the U.S. to stop sales of some of its cars that are equipped with seat heaters. The firm said that a portion of the seat fabric in the affected models could burn at a rate faster than allowed by U.S. regulations. The models affected by the move include the Avalon, Camry, Corolla, Sienna, Tacoma, and Tundra. Toyota said no fires or injuries had been reported due to the issue. The firm said that nearly 36,000 vehicles currently with dealers, about 13% of their inventory, would be affected by the decision. However, that number does not include vehicles that may have already been sold or those in transit to the dealers. Social networking giant Facebook has reported profits of $523 million and a 63% increase in revenue for the fourth quarter, beating expectations. The boost in revenue was mostly due to stronger mobile advertising sales. Advertising revenue increased 76% from the same period last year. Overall, Facebook said it had 757 million daily global users as of December 2013. For the full year of 2013, Facebook reported profits of $1.5 billion and said its daily active users grew by 22%. And while such giant Google reported fourth quarter profits of $3.38 billion, up 17% from a year earlier, buoyed by stronger advertising revenue. Google also announced the stock split will take place on 2nd April. The company reported a widening loss of $384 million in its Motorola mobility unit compared to $152 million in 2012. Google announced the surprise sale of that business late on Wednesday to Chinese computer maker Lenovo for $2.91 billion. A lot of money in virtual business. The sports after this. Welcome back. Now, the Ghana Football Association has confirmed the Black Stars will engage Montenegro in an international friendly in March after sealing a deal with the Brave Falcons. This brings to two the number of secure friendlies after the FA concluded negotiations with the Deutsche Football Association for a friendly in May between the Stars and the Orange 4 days ago. The matches form part of the team's preparation for the World Cup in June. A French court has dropped charges of sex with an underage prostitute against footballers Franck Ribéry and Karim Benzema. The judge ruled there was insufficient proof the men were aware that Zahia Deha was a minor at the time the alleged offences took place. The two footballers who denied the charges had faced up to 3 years in prison if convicted. The age of consent is 15 in France, but paying for sex with anyone under 18 is a crime. Mali midfielder Seydou Keita has joined Valencia until the end of the season. The Spanish club revealed on Thursday. The 34-year-old former Barcelona player arrives at the club on a free transfer from Chinese side Dalian Aibin. Valencia said on their website that Keita's deal will run until 30th June with an option for another season. Keita won 14 trophies in 4 seasons with Barcelona between 2008 and 2012 and has also been capped 88 times by his country, scoring 24 goals. AC Milan has signed QPR midfielder Adel Taarabt on loan with a view to a permanent transfer in the summer. The 24-year-old had been on loan at Premier League club Fulham since last summer, but has now joined the Italian giants until the end of the season. Taarabt told AC Milan's official website that he is very happy to be at Milan, adding, "It's an honour to play for the strongest team in Italy." Taarabt began his career at Lens before moving to Tottenham in 2007. Transfer news, players including Michael Acey. Welcome back. In other news, the former leader of Uganda's main opposition party, the Forum for Democratic Change, says his struggle is not about being president of Uganda, rather one that seeks qualitative changes in Uganda. Kizza Besigye said he has been fighting for a Uganda that is well governed, free of human rights abuses, and where resources are distributed equitably, free of corruption. In April 2011, he and a group called Activists for Change began the Walk to Work protests to express their concerns about people's dissatisfaction with rising prices. Since then, Besigye says he has been in and out of jail countless times. He says the authorities have told him they are keeping him under preventive detention. In nearby Togo, police have made their second major ivory discovery in a week. More than 2 tons of ivory were found in a container destined for Vietnam, bringing the total found so far to almost 4 tons. Togo's Environment Minister Andre Johnson Said said all the containers were part of the same shipment found at Lomé Port. 2 Togolese men and a Vietnamese citizen have already been arrested in connection with the finds. Conservationists say the West African country has become a major hub for the illegal ivory trade between Central Africa and Asia. The U.S. government says it will seek the death penalty against Boston Marathon bombing suspect Zakir Saniv. U.S. Attorney General Eric Holder said in a statement, the nature of the conduct at issue and the resultant harm compel the decision. 17 of 30 charges against the 20-year-old carry the possibility of capital punishment, including using a weapon of mass destruction to kill. The bombings killed 3 and injured more than 260 in April 2013. Saniv has pleaded not guilty and no trial date has been set. Actress Nanama McBrown has been thanking God for her life and that of her fiancé Maxwell for escaping death when they were involved in an accident on the N1 highway last year. She suffered a broken arm and was hospitalized at the 37 Military Hospital for close to a month. The versatile actress has donated assorted items and cash to the Teshi Orphanage to thank God for her deliverance.
Today, January 30, marks exactly 1 year since the actress Nanama McBrown and her cutie boyfriend Maxwell were involved in a motor accident on the George Walker Bush Highway in the early hours of January 30, 2013. 1 year on, the sensational actress and her fiancé are still thanking God for the gift of life. This they did at the Teshi Orphanage. The couple, together with some family members, donated items and a cash amount of £200 to the orphanage. According to Nanama, she couldn't let the day go by without showing love to somebody.
It's about saying thank you to God. It's not about what we're given, but it's about saying thank you to God for giving us life. As you can see on my cake, you say thank you, God, for life. So a year by now, I would have been dead and gone. And a year by now, I would say I was in a coma. It wasn't in coma, but I was off. For 24 hours, I couldn't see anything. And I want to say thank you to God for giving me the opportunity to live again.
Janet Nye is an assistant to the founder of the orphanage. She expressed gratitude to the actress on behalf of the orphanage. The orphanage is encouraging members of the entertainment industry to emulate Nanama's example to help support the orphanage.
The department Department of Women's and Gender Studies at Rutgers University is offering a class called Politicizing Beyoncé. Kevin Ulrich, who is teaching the class, said he was using the singer's career to explore American race, gender, and sexual politics. The class includes analysis of Beyoncé's videos and lyrics, as well as readings from black feminists. Ulrich also said he wanted to help students at the university in New Jersey think more critically about media consumption. He said, this isn't a course about Beyoncé's political engagement or how many times she performed during President Obama's inauguration weekend. This is News Today, a recap of our headlines. An University of Ghana legal team says it is now studying the documents of the suit served them last Wednesday on their decision to charge tolls on the university's roads. Association of Ghana Industries Business Barometer report reveals the biggest challenge faced by businesses in the manufacturing sector is high utility prices. Former leader of Uganda's main opposition party, the Forum for Democratic Change, says his struggle is not about being president of Uganda, but one that seeks qualitative changes in Uganda. That'll be all for the hour. Thank you very much for staying through. There's more news on mindjoyonline.com. Have yourself a good weekend. My name is Kamini Nyamani Amana. Goodbye for now.